At the Brook Theatre, we did everything. Acted, stage managed, painted sets, directed replacement casts, went on long tours, oh, you name it. Brian Brook was always Mr. Brook to strangers, Brookie when in favour, and old Brooklax when not. Petrina we called Tweets. Tweets was a tiny, pint-sized woman with a huge sense of humour and a heart as big as a house. She loved the bush and safaris, and when not in the theatre was usually dressed in khaki shorts and shirts with her dogs and her survival kit, gin. She would rattle off into the bush in her station wagon. Once I was watching her on their farm manoeuvring a huge pig through a gate by holding it by the balls. She saw me and said, oh God, darling, if only I could have handled some of my actors like this, I'd have been a much happier woman. Both Brian and Petrina directed. Brian was a keen golfer, and he always moved us about in golfing terms. Keep in the fairway, old boy. Good putt, old chap. Don't move on that line, you duffer. You'll land the scene in a bunker. Don't hang on to the furniture, you two. If you act the scene that way, the audience will hit the 19th hole before the first green. Tweets was a trainer of young actors par excellence. I can still hear her now. Darling, you're upset, so don't sit back in that chair. You look as though you're telling Mother Goose nursery stories. It looks so defeated. You'll bore them to death. They want some tension. Darlings, this is a comedy. Enjoy yourselves. Smile. No, Pandora, don't bare your teeth like that. You look like a fox that's just consumed a chicken. You'll frighten them to death. Smile warmly from the heart. Oh, she has one, that is. Carved from stone, I'll be bound. I wish one of you boys would take her away for the weekend and do something to her. Loosen her up a bit. Brian, what are you and Manny doing with the lights? I can't see their eyes. Where are the footlights? Oh, doing without them this time. Their old wave. Old wave or new wave, bugger the waves. I want to see their eyes. They'll say we've cast a bunch of corpses. And Heather, darling, not that dead white face again. You're aiding and abetting those two fools. You are an emerging sex kitten, not a clapped out one. Shortly after I joined the Brook Company, Two for the Seesaw went into rehearsal. It was a two-hander with Brian and Heather and Tweets directing. On opening night, Brian came along, made a long speech all about a dressmaker's dummy standing in a corner. At the end of the speech, he turned round to put his hat on the dummy, and no dummy. It had not been set. This rattled him somewhat and got him off to a bad leg. We feared the worst. Well, the next day, the newspapers gave Heather the most fantastic raves. It was the performance that established her as a dramatic actress of the first water. The original billing of the show had been Brian Brook in Two for the Seesaw with Heather Lloyd-Jones. The papers that night billed it this way. A star is born. Heather Lloyd-Jones in Two for the Seesaw with Brian Brook. When it came time to tour the play, Brian decided he'd better tour it in tandem with the light comedy. He rewrote an absurd American play called Champagne Complex. It was all about a delicious girl who took off her clothes whenever she drank champagne and had to call in a shrink, a lay psychiatrist, I ask you. Heather was the girl and I was her pompous boyfriend. Brian was the psychiatrist. When it was time for the dress rehearsal, Brian said, I think I'll ask old Pegs to come and watch. This was Margaret Ingalls, mother of Prue Leith, the cooking whiz, a deeply distinguished actress, usually billed at her own command, as South Africa's finest actress. Well, came she did, and cracked not a smile. She and Brian had a long chat afterwards, and we all sat chewing our nails. Well, said Brian, old Pegs loathed it and said it was a disgrace and a flop, and we should shelve it at once, but don't look so alarmed. If she'd liked it, I would have considered taking it off. But as she hated it, I know we have a hit on our hands. And sure enough, we did. So much so that during the tour, Seesaw, despite its marvellous notices, failed at the box office and was dropped in favour of Complex, which got terrible notices but packed the theatres. When Brian announced the dropping of Seesaw, Heather's tantrums were enough to quell an invasion from Soviet Russia in its entirety. But Complex established her as a box office star of enormous magnitude. We ran to packed houses for 2 years in Johannesburg. Of course, once they decided she had it, the Brooks did all they could to enhance her image. I can still remember tweets saying to Pam Lewis, the set designer, "Pam, darling, we're getting tired of your lovely sets painted with shit-coloured paint. It's the fashion? Well, it's a very depressing one from here. And while I'm thinking about your divine sets, we're developing Heather as our star, God help us all. So next time, have the doors made smaller and the furniture. It will help give her some stature." And a last note, when Heather comes on, lift the whole lighting board 4 points, and when she goes off, lower it 4 points. They'll say, what a clever girl she is. Lights up the whole stage with her personality. Don't overdo it now, or we'll look fools. Now that Heather had conquered comedy and drama, Brian decided it was time to star her in a musical. "Are you mad?" she said. "I can't sing." "Never mind, darling, you're an actress," said Brian. "You'll pull the wool over their eyes." Well, it was tantrums all the way. Heather swearing she would never forgive this wicked management for doing this to her. Never, 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 never. She was quite something to behold. Once she even threw herself down on the floor and quite literally bit the carpet. By opening night, we were wrecks. Halfway through the first act, I was listening and quite audibly said, "She's flat." She heard me on stage and at interval chased me around the backstage with her stiletto shoe, shrieking, "You bastard!" Then she slammed her door shut and said she wasn't going to go on for the second half. "Oh, yes, you are," said Tweets. Heather flung herself on the floor and said, "I'm not!" Tweets gave her a crack on the ear that would have felled a lumberjack, and Heather fled to the stage, snarling. Halfway through Act Two, there was an upheaval, and the set designer and his beautiful black girlfriend rushed into the stage door, muttering, "The police are after us! Save us!" They shimmied up the fly tower ladder and disappeared way overhead into the flies. Two policemen came striding into the green room. "Through there," said the company, pointing to the door which led to the street. They rushed off and the day was saved. Finally, the curtain fell to tumultuous applause. Heather had curtain call after curtain call, the audience on their feet cheering. Irma La Douce, as the musical was called, was one mother of a hit. It ran a year in Johannesburg and a year on tour. During the latter part of the nationwide tour, Heather took ill with nodules on her vocal cords and exhaustion. The doctors absented her and she returned to Joburg while her understudy took over. We arrived in Durban, which was at capacity. Brian walked out onto the stage and announced to the audience that the understudy would be appearing that night. The majority of the audience got up and demanded their money back. Brian and Petrina flew back to Johannesburg to persuade Heather to return. "Yes," she said, "on one condition." Her salary had been just less than the orchestra leader, and she demanded realistic payment. It was granted, and henceforth she became the highest paid actress in the country. After this long tour of Irma La Douce, I went back home to Grahamstown for a rest. I arrived at the house, but nobody appeared to be there, so I took a bath. The water was cold, and so reverting to my rather colonial upbringings, I yelled for the maid Delilah Jane to bring me some hot water. This she did, and was pouring it into the bath. The next thing, my grandfather's horrified face appeared at the doorway, and he said, "Your father will hear about this." When my father came home for lunch, I was called literally before the hearth, and seeing his chance, he told me to leave this sinful profession once and for all, and that a full discussion would ensue when he returned from work. As soon as he'd left, I hitchhiked to Port Elizabeth caught the plane back to Johannesburg and didn't speak to him again for 3 years. Having arrived back in Johannesburg, I was in need of work again. I was not yet permanently with the Brook Company. I called on everyone to no avail. As a last resort, I contacted the whiplash-tongued Robert Langford, who'd also worked for them but was now doing something for the fearsome Toby Kushlick. He greeted me with surprise and charm. "Yes, yes, you'll do very well. Toby is presenting the Irish actor in his one-man show, The Importance of Being Oscar. I'm to manage him and we need a dresser. You always looked after your costumes well. We'll even tour you. His name is Michael McClearmore." A dresser? No matter, I was in work. "He's arriving later in the week. The team will be at the airport to meet him. Here's a program so you don't make an ass of yourself." I studied his biography. Indeed, here was a luminary actor, writer, designer, painter, acted with Peggy Ashcroft and Orson Welles, created famous theatres in Ireland, toured the world with his companies, a celebrated raconteur and favourite with ambassadors, dukes, kings, and welcome at their tables. I was thoroughly alarmed. On the appointed day at the airport, there was the press in abundance and the Irish Guard, all wearing green carnations, the badge of Oscar Wilde. Toby pushed me firmly into the background. Oh, she was never one to bring forward an underling. The plane had arrived, and into the VIP lounge, amidst the popping of flash bulbs, was ushered a butterball of a man in what was quite clearly a jet black toupee, and it seemed extravagantly maquillaged. He began answering questions in a dark velvet voice with Irish overtones. During a pause, a journalist come critic lady asked a question. She was wearing Minnie Mouse shoes, lisle stockings, her hair in a bun, and had a large hooked nose. Peering sharply over her half-moon spectacles, she said, "Mr. McClearmore, you're doing the life of Oscar Wilde. What are your personal opinions on the subject of homosexuality?" Barely missing a beat, he replied, "Madam, it is the natural and understandable refuge of a sensitive male from women such as you." The following day, I was at the Playhouse Theatre, waiting outside the dressing room for the arrival of himself, when I heard coming up the rather steep stairs this liquid chocolate voice saying, "Oh, God, Aubrey, these steps are too much for Magda. She can't take it. Is this Everest to be challenged every time a poor bedraggled performer leaves the stage? It must perforce lead to a breathless evening in the theatre." And around the corner he came, a frightening toupee and heavily made up, I assumed, for the dress rehearsal. "Michael," said Robert Langford. "Where was Aubrey?" "This is John, your dresser." "Ah, my dresser." A sharp glance from heavily cauled lids, a sigh, and then with a twinkle and a very naughty one, "Ah, and what a pretty little girl you are too. But never mind, you have nothing to fear from this bedraggled artiste. You see, when I was young, I always did the favour to people with whom I went to bed, and I still like to do the favour, so you can imagine what I have to go to bed to do that." We retired to the dressing room and he closed the door firmly. "Now, Hortense, for that is what I've named you, I shall pay you £3 a week to augment what is no doubt the princely salary you're receiving from this management. Your first duty is to keep this door firmly locked against the intrusion of Mr. Robert Langford. I am Irish, you know, and have second sight, and find Robert faintly sinister and definitely not to be admitted to the secrets of the boudoir." "And what about Aubrey?" "Toby, well, I don't think she should make those stairs without the aid of a broomstick, and something tells me she wouldn't like to be seen with one." As for after-show visitors, certainly not until we have completed our offstage toilette. And now, Hortense, while we lay out the necessary implements of transformation, I shall school you into one or two other requirements. One of these was to meet him at the edge of the stage after the first curtain call, with a gin and ginger ale for himself to quaff before striding on for the second curtain call. If there is a second call, Hortense, if indeed there is a first, the audience having drifted out one by one like rays into the darkness, leaving this poor strolling player to brave the mists of darkest Africa all on his own. No, Hortense, that must not happen. If it does, we shall, you and I, wander into the streets of this city, which I have it on good authority, are paved with gold. We shall make our fortunes. Even better, we shall visit a gold mine and plunge headfirst into the abyss and meet Mephistopheles and come to a happy arrangement to have future performances filled to the brim. No doubt he and Toby are charitably acquainted. So, there is nothing to fret about. Now let us descend Mount Everest and discover what hazards are to befall us at this rehearsal. It'll be a late, late night, methinks. I noticed an African maiden at the door, so beautiful. Eyes, two detonated moons in the midnight of the flesh. Ah, Africa. Of course, by now I adored him. I also learned who the mysterious Aubrey was. This was an allusion to Mrs. Patrick Campbell's husband. Mrs. Pat, of course, was the celebrated actress who often referred to her late husband, Aubrey, when in extremis. Oh, Aubrey, what am I to do? Well, I think she loved him very much because she'd said, ah, the deep peace of the marriage bed after the hurly-burly of the chaise longue. Well, McLeamore and I became firm friends, and he then required me to come daily and dress him at the Carlton Hotel. Extra remuneration, no objections, and not a word to the management. Of course, he didn't really want to be dressed. He wanted an audience to listen and laugh at his wicked observations and irrepressible humour. During luncheon in the Carlton Grill was an unforgettable experience. Oh, do stop laughing so extravagantly, Hortense. Or the waiters will say, there goes that dreadful Mrs. McLeamore and her inebriated French maid. I asked him once if he'd played Oedipus. Oh, yes, indeed. I thought I was quite wonderful. But at the dress rehearsal, Hilton, my partner, raised me to the ground and said, Michel, do try to remember that Oedipus was a Greek king, not an Italian fishwife. I never toured with him. More's the pity, for I went into a production of Don't Tell Father for the Brooks. We were now well into the 60s and theatre was flourishing. Jaime Udwin with his Academy Theatre and Rex Garner, the Langford Ingalls Company with Margaret Ingalls, still South Africa's finest actress, the monstrous Toby Kushlick, Roy Cook with the Alexander Theatre, the Brook, the Playhouse Company, and of course the golden boy to be Peter Turin was beginning to become a force to be reckoned with. In Cape Town, there was Leonard Schach and the Cockpit Players, as well as The Space with Yvonne Briceland and Brian Asprey. The Brickhill Burke Company was about to hit town with Oklahoma and stay on to triumphant success. These but to name a few. It's hard to believe that there were so many companies that there wasn't a shortage of work, rather often a shortage of actors. I had become a sort of matinee idol. Yes, I know, what happened? Often in those days, I was referred to as that promising young actor, John Whiteley. Then I read that I was veteran actor, John Whiteley. I never actually arrived. At the Brook Theatre, Heather and I rehearsed barefoot in the park. Tweets her usual blunt self. Heather, darling, stop shimmying about as if you've got ants in your pants. And Johnny, if you will insist on dropping your inflections, you'll bring the safety curtain down with a crash, darling. we opened with yet another success. When we were about to set off on tour, Tweet said, "Now you two, you'll be getting lots of press coverage, so don't fall into the trap of believing your own publicity, darlings. After all, if that box of surf over there believed its own advertisement, it would be too grand to watch anything." We were doing this play at the Labia Theatre in Cape Town when I was initiated into public speaking. One night during interval, the theatre manager came to me backstage and said that as it was Heather's birthday, he had arranged that at the last curtain call, the curtain would stay up. "Happy birthday to you" would play over the speaker system. We should all turn, applaud Heather, and the ushers would come down with bouquets of flowers, and the cast and audience would sing along. But if anything should go wrong with the sound system and no music burst forth, would I step forward, silence the audience, and ask them to join the cast in a happy birthday applause for Heather? The final curtain stayed up, but no music. So I stepped forward, quietened the audience, and said with a great aplomb, "Ladies and gentlemen, please would you join Heather Lloyd-Jones in wishing me a happy birthday?"